This morning's Eastertide message comes just after the resurrection of Jesus in the Gospel of Luke. Right before today's passage, we're told that Mary, the mother of James, and other women went to the tomb with spices that they had prepared. Yet they found the stone to the tomb rolled away in the tomb empty. And two men appear in dazzling clothes and ask the women what they're looking for the living among the dead. And the women that run to the temple, or I'm sorry, the women who run to the tomb, then run to the disciples and tell them what has happened, that Jesus has been raised from the dead, that the stone has been rolled away, that the tomb is empty. And we're told that many don't believe the women, but Peter gets up from his place and he runs to the tomb and he finds it empty, but he doesn't find Jesus there. Now on the same day that all of this has taken place in Luke's gospel, two Jesus followers are making their way along the road to a village called Emmaus. And when I was a kid, I remember sleeping in my grandparents' spare bedroom, and the bed was directly under a massive painting of the walk to Emmaus. Jesus and two guys walking on a road that didn't seem to have an end in that painting. I'm pretty sure it was on my grandparents' bedroom wall for like 50 years. The scripture tells us that Emmaus is about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and this might be the same Emmaus that Jewish historian Flavius Josephus talks about in his writing called The Jewish War, in which he talks about Emmaus being chosen by a Roman emperor, Vespasian, as the site of a Roman colony around the year 70 AD. And Josephus is one of the most important voices of Jewish antiquity in the time of the early church because he lived from about 37 to 100 AD. So Josephus was born not too many years after the death and resurrection of Jesus and was alive while the early church was being formed. We're told that these two who are walking on the road are talking about all these things that have happened, and while they're talking, Jesus himself comes up to them on the road, but we're told that their eyes are kept from recognizing him. Not that they're literally blind, but Luke wants us to understand that their senses have been supernaturally dulled. And Jesus, or this strange man on the road, asks them, "What are you discussing with each other while you are walking?" And we're told that the two followers stand still, so they've stopped walking, at least for now. They look sad, but they don't just look sad, they are sad. They're upset. They're probably a bit scared. Jesus was alive, and then he was killed by the government. They are sad, and they are grieving. Then Cleopas, who could be the same Cleopas mentioned in John 19:25, but we're not really sure, answers the question with a question, because this is the Bible after all. "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" And then Jesus, like Jesus does, answers the question with a question. He asks, "What things?" Two words. What things? What things? We can almost see these two men looking at each other and maybe scratching their heads like this, saying, "Who is this guy? How does the stranger on the road to Emmaus not know what has happened? not know what things. What things they were discussing before he approached the life of Jesus. His teachings, his performing healings, the miracles, Jesus being the one who showed the presence of God's kingdom in complete opposition to the kingdom of the Roman Empire. Jesus showing that God is the God of the covenant and that the covenant remains with God's people. Jesus the prophet, Jesus feeding people, Jesus going to the margins of society, Jesus interacting with women as if they're human beings and not property, Jesus making people aware that God is inclusive. The betrayals, the arrest, the trial, if you can call it that, and the violent death of Jesus. What things? All of those things. They go on to say, we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel, or the one to set Israel free, but it is now the third day since these things took place. And then they tell us that they know about the empty tomb, which we didn't know that they knew until verse 22. The men go on to say, moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and they did not find his body there. And they came back, and they told us that they had seen a vision of angels who told them that he was alive. So now we have complete confirmation that these two followers were with the other followers when they found out about the resurrection. And they tell Jesus, still not knowing that it's him, that some of those with them went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they didn't see Jesus there. And remember, some of those people didn't believe what the women said. But we also have to remember that in the time of Jesus, women were not reliable sources. They were not reliable witnesses. They were just property. Jesus reprimands the two, yet they don't really understand it as scolding from Jesus because they don't know it's him yet. And Jesus puts it right out there, and he says to them, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart you are to believe all that the prophets have declared. This is another one of those instances like last week's sermon on Thomas, where Jesus is saying, oh, so you don't believe just because you didn't see? Or just because Peter didn't run smack into me when he ran to the tomb? I wasn't there to greet you in my resurrected form, so you don't believe? But these two don't comprehend what he's saying, at least not yet. And we're not told they have any sort of comeback for what's been said to them for doubting what has taken place. Instead, we're told that they're now near the village in verse 28, which means they obviously started walking at some point. And Jesus, still not recognizable, starts to walk ahead of them like he's going on down the road, but they urge him to stay with them because it's almost evening. We're not told that they were in a room or lodged with someone else. So maybe these two are originally from Emmaus. Maybe they're returning home after all of these things. They probably don't want this man to continue down the road because the road is dangerous. Dark places are dangerous. Dark roads are for robbers and other nefarious creatures and characters to rob people, to injure people, to kill people. So these two disciples of Jesus are actually living out his teachings. by inviting this man that they don't even recognize into lodge with them overnight, in for safety and in for a meal. He stays with them, and it's only when he breaks the bread, blesses, and he says, they say, "We know who you are." They recognize him when he breaks the bread. This is the one whose body was given for us. This is the one whose blood was shed for us. And I wonder exactly what it was that Jesus said when he gave the blessing that made them realize it was him. Or maybe he did it in a way that it was familiar. Like, wait a minute, we've seen this before. And as suddenly as they realize that it's Jesus, he vanishes from their sight. They cannot truly see him while they were on the road with him, but now that they can see him, he is no longer there. It's got to be more than a little frustrating for them. And now they realize that Jesus was breaking open scriptures on the road, breaking open the word, but they didn't understand. They didn't understand until he broke the bread. And even though they spent all that time walking 7 miles, 7 miles is quite a ways to walk during that time. And even though it was dark and possibly dangerous on the road, these two hurry back to Jerusalem to the other disciples. They walk sadly on the road to Emmaus. But imagine the happy sprint they're doing back to Jerusalem. They find the 11 disciples and others gathered together, and they hear that the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon, though we're not given the details of that vision in today's scripture. The two tell the others who are gathered what has happened on the road to Emmaus. Through living out a life of service like Jesus taught them, they came to know who he was that night. I wonder if they stopped to even consider, what if they had never invited him in for safety? What if they would have let Jesus continue to walk down that road? They tell the others how Jesus has been made known to them in the breaking of the bread, something familiar to all of the disciples at this point. And we echo those early followers of Jesus today. Jesus is made known to us in the breaking of the bread, an act so sacred, an act so holy, that we do it every week in this church. How would we feel if we came to church and didn't take communion? Be a bit different? I bet some people would be angry. An act so sacred. However, we must make sure that we see Jesus and truly recognize Jesus in other places as well. This is a lesson from those two disciples. Jesus is not in the tomb. Jesus is risen. We don't break bread to remember a Savior who was crucified, and that's the end of the story. We break bread because we serve a living God, because Jesus was put in the tomb and after 3 days was raised. After 3 days, the tomb was empty. And Jesus said to his disciples during the Last Supper, "This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The breaking of the bread is a starting point. Do this in remembrance of me. And once you remember, get busy, because you're disciples. I've laid the groundwork. I I've laid the cornerstone. I am the cornerstone. Now build upon it. Don't just sit there and remember and be inactive. Jesus says, this is my body given for you. And that calls us into a life of service to God and to each other in and outside of this church. The two men on the road to Emmaus were probably going home. They thought that everything was done. What's left now that there's no Jesus to see? The tomb is empty, but we haven't seen him, they're probably thinking. And in their moment of sadness, and in their moment of grief, and their feelings of defeat, their feelings of confusion, Jesus shows up and follows them home and breaks the bread and calls them back into discipleship. He calls them back into community with their other brothers and sisters. Maybe we feel like we're on the road to Emmaus, but we're not seeing Jesus. I think we can identify with what the kids said earlier. Maybe we're not even sure we're on the road, if we're being honest. What we can be sure about is that we will gather at this table this morning, like those two disciples, we will be called back into service. Every week we are called back into service in this church, and every week we remember what has been given for us. We remember the life, the teachings, the death, and the resurrection. And this table calls us to be disciples. This ends this morning's lesson. Thanks be to God.